Hi, my name is Joseph Omsili, a researcher at Penn State. For the past 5 years, we've been working with a team of farmers, scientists, and extension educators to learn more about cover crop mixtures. For decades, farmers have been using cover crops to improve soil health and suppress weeds. Usually just one cover crop is planted as a monoculture. But recently, we've seen more and more farmers experiment with cover crop mixtures of 3 to more than a dozen species. We've been using controlled experiments and on-farm research to help farmers understand the benefits and challenges of using cover crop mixtures. In this video, you'll hear our farmers and collaborators reflect on why they're using mixtures.
We grow corn, soybeans, spelt, and alfalfa hay, alfalfa grass mixed hay. Those are the main crops that we grow. We also do certified organic vegetables too, but that's only about an acre. It's a small kind of side business. One of the main reasons that we're planting the cover crop is to try to get nitrogen production, have nitrogen for our corn crop that's going to be planted into that ground. So therefore, we were mainly looking at legumes in the past, trying to have the legumes produce as much nitrogen as possible. And that's pretty much what we have done up until this point. I would like to look into doing mixtures more of adding in maybe other things like different grasses or other non-legume plants that might scavenge and pull up nitrogen that's left from the previous crop. And so we have kind of a combination of plants that are producing the nitrogen that we need and also other plants that are gathering the nitrogen that's left in the soil and providing that for the next, for our corn crop. Some of that, and also trying to look, looking at timing of what crops can be planted well together. One of the things with our equipment, looking at our drill, we don't have, the grass box doesn't work on our drill, so all of anything kind of mixture we plant, we want to mix it all together and be able to plant it in one pass. And so therefore, we need to look at things that, that mix well and will go through the drill well. So we don't have to make multiple passes or try to get some other kind of equipment to plant the cover crops. So some of those are some of the things we're looking at.
We had been in the process of experimenting with lower input, reduced herbicide and mechanical weed control for several years before that, in mid-90s. And we're able to see that we could get away with weed control, which was our biggest hang-up, which most guys, it's the biggest hang-up, to go in organic or to going without chemicals for weed control herbicides. And so that we went into it and decided that we could do it. And then, like I said, the first year was 2001, and then 2002 we were certified on all of our home acres here, which is 270 acres. I have seen a lot of improvement in the soils where we're using cover crops over just a corn and soybean rotation. And of course, after 3 years of alfalfa grass hay, it makes a terrific corn or canola feeding crop. And so the cover crops have a tremendous benefit as far as the root systems that they put in the soil, which increase the organic matter and also produce nitrogen and green manure to be plowed down. And on our rented farm, we're using some cover crops because there we don't put hay out. So we usually have a small grain seeded in the spring, and then after that comes off, then we'll put a cover crop for the corn then for the next year. So I like a cover crop that survives the winter. It's not real expensive, but I also like to have a small grain in there because I think that helps, and we've seen that in this project, is it seems to help the survivability of the legumes into the winter and over the winter. And then also the cover crop has to be something that reaches pretty much full maturity by, the 10th of May. If you have to wait till the 10th of June, which is generally the case like with vetch, it's a little slower coming, although there are some earlier maturing ones, I guess, now. But the winter peas do that well. The crimson clover does that well. even more so than the medium red clover as far as early maturity and kind of reaching the peak of nitrogen fixing ability and biomass as early as in May as possible.
One of the main benefits I would see is just that depending on when you plant, what the climatic conditions are like, whether it's dry or whether it's wet, hot or cold, that can really affect which plants flourish and don't do well. And so by having the mixture, it kind of, to me, again, like talking about kind of an insurance policy, kind of, I like having a variety out there because that way, you know, one year one crop might do a little better and next year another crop might do better. And so that would be some of the benefits. And then, of course, having the variety of different plants growing, having the different roots down there in the soil, I know that's benefiting the, you know, the microbial life. There's different things like different plants. They like variety and diversity. And so having that in there, I know that I'm getting a benefit to my soil by having a mixture. And so those are some of the things I like about having the mixture and the fact that I know they're going to be cycling different nutrients depending on their roots and different things like that. The challenge again though is trying to come up with a mixture that you plant the right amount of each thing, because from what we noticed in the plots that we had canola in a mixture and it tended to dominate and kind of choke out a lot of the other things, a lot of the other species of the cover crops that are in there. And so trying to come up with the right rate I think is key, and that might vary from each farm. I think depending on where you're at in the state or in the region, and then also the weather at the time of planting, you know, trying to come up with those mixtures, that's a challenge, I think, is just trying that and having the equipment that to be able to plant it all at one time so you don't have to go out there and seed two things, go back and seed two or three other things, just be able to plant it all at one time and be done.
I think the benefits are that you know, you might have some times, some seasons where one particular variety or one particular crop in the mix of cover crops, either for lack of moisture, for lack of warmth or cold, doesn't take off as good in the fall as it should. You have some others that kind of fill in. And I think that's maybe as much as anything a really good benefit to the mixtures. And again, we saw that in our trials. we saw one cover crop mix be altogether just one, basically, you know, crop in canola the other year. And so I think that's one thing. I think the fact that even if it gets started good, you know, maybe the winter's one way or the spring's another way, and does it lend itself to one of the particular crops in that mix. And so I think that's probably the main advantage. I think the one challenge can be getting it seeded, you know, at the right depth. You know, some seed that's real small, you might be afraid you're going to get it too deep if you put it in as deep as some of the larger seeded mixtures. So sometimes you have to maybe use a drill that has a small seed box and a large seed box. And so it's a little more hassle putting the seed in that way. And if you have to mix it all together, you know, that's kind of a hassle too, doing that. But I guess for the, you know, for the little bit of time that it takes, it's probably worth it. And I know nowadays these cover crop seed guys are mixing them for people, you know, putting them together, mixing them up however you want them configured in the ratio of one species to the next. So there's ways that, you know, we're going to be able to get around some of those things too.